Connor's been everything we expected he would be and more.
He's the fastest, most skilled, talented player in the history of the game, period.
Right out in front, what a pass, what a goal!
How do you defend him?
For McDavid magic!
40-plus goals for the first time, won the Art Ross again.
Scores! What a goal by Connor McDavid! Oh, man!
If you're going to ask the players around the league who the best offensive player in the world is, Connor McDavid would be the consensus answer.
McDavid scores! Connor McDavid! 97 makes it all happen! Spectacular! McDavid scores! Connor McDavid! He's incredible, isn't he?
Nobody's catching him. It's like he's skating downhill as to everybody else skating uphill.
You can't stop this kid when he gets in full flight. This is incredible. Just an unreal play by Connor McDavid. That's not fair.
Doesn't matter who plays with him. He'll make a mistake.
He is the best.
Welcome to NHL Tonight, Breakdowns and Demos. I'm Jameson Coyle. We all know how special a talent Connor McDavid is. He's already being compared to hockey immortals. His speed, skill set, and hockey IQ make him the best in the world. And the 2017 MVP can break down a defense and put the puck in the net using incredible moves like these. But as Stu Grimson shows us, sometimes it's best when you keep it simple. Check it out. Connor McDavid, we mentioned him. You noticed something from his game last night that jumped off the page to you. What did you see?
It did. It gave me a little insight into the defensive side of his game. And not to say that it has mass shortcomings, but I just think it's something that needs to evolve over time. And last night kind of gave me a little bit of insight in that respect. You love the skill set. He's got these tools in his toolbox that a lot of players don't have, but sometimes the simpler play might be the better play. He's got this little kick. This, I call it a bunny hop. Johnny, he kind of kicks it from his back trailing skate up to his stick, and he recovers possession, and he does it almost without breaking stride. It's a nifty little play. He does it with extreme precision, but there are moments when he tries to apply that, and this is a situation where he applied it right here. A better play, rather than trying to use the stick, you're really in a stick-on-stick battle with the defender, Ristolainen, in this situation. I'd rather see him not use that particular tool, use the stick-on-stick play. In that instance, it goes back on him, and it ends up costing Edmonton the 1-1 goal. Here's a great read. McDavid recognizes late in the game, game on the line, they're trying to close it down. Love the defensive recognition, shows up on the right side of the battle, strips it from Jack Eichel, and at a critical moment in this game, shuts it all down, wins that battle, and it's really just using the very simplest tools in his toolbox. It's the speed, it's the quick stick, it's the being able to stop on a dime and re-accelerate, regather speed. But like the application late in the game with the game on the line. And again, I think the takeaway for Connor McDavid, sometimes, although you're a very sophisticated high-end talent, sometimes the simpler play is better.
Braden Shen was gone for the past six games, and they have certainly missed him. Bozak in the slot, Tarasenko pulls the trigger. Shen gets a touch on this.
Boy, he did that while doing the Victor Arvidsson jump. An immediate impact for Shen back in the lineup.
The Ducks put it in the empty net to take a 4-3 lead.
Rebound scores! Robert Thomas has tied it. 12 seconds later, tipped in, and the Blues lead.
You can bring out the Zamboni as the St. Louis Blues pull one out of the fire.
The W's keep coming for the St. Louis Blues. This week featured a dramatic comeback win over the Ducks that saw both Robert Thomas and Alex Pietrangelo score in the final minutes of regulation to seal the crazy come-from-behind victory. Let's see how the Blues were able to steal a win out west.
So the Blues come back in the final 90 seconds of the game, scoring two apart, 12 seconds apart. Take us through sort of the goals here.
Yeah, it was interesting. I mean, the Blues had the extra attacker on for the first of the two goals, the tying goal, and it just really, they just outnumber the Ducks down low, or they get the three guys around the net. You see Maroon is down there, Thomas is down there, and Parayko was just shooting to get this through. And, you know, this is just a good fortune. He hits the dasher, and watch that dasher. That's really hard, right? So you're going to get a true bounce off that, and this couldn't be any truer.
That is the perfect bounce, and you can't rely on this in every rink. Detroit, the old Joe,
they
would have a play. Lidstrom would bounce it off the wall, would bounce right back. But you're right. To get that to come right to Thomas, I mean, that's just an amazing bounce. Good job by Parayko, though.
Yeah, and then he finished nicely on that play. And then on this one, really just a turnover by the Blues, and it ends up really a nice play by Shen. You can see Megna has that puck. Just take it behind the net. Instead, he leaves. He throws it up to nobody. Shen is there. He's got all this room to pass to. He hits Petrangelo, and then he goes to net. Petrangelo is making a shot pass here. And because Henrique goes to the net with Shen, he's there. The puck hits Henrique's skate and goes in, and that's kind of the year it's been. And you can see how Braden Shen has impacted this team, Jack.
12-0 since the All-Star break's pretty good, or since January 23rd.
Yeah.
That just shows what he can add. I mean, the way he plays hard, right? I mean, he's a guy in the forecheck. He'll run you over. Then he's got the skill to make plays, like you saw him find Petrangelo there on that nice pass. So he's a great player that does. You can understand that their lineup's just so much better with him in it.
Yeah, no question about that. It'll be fun to see how things continue for the Blues because they're rolling.
I love it. Ryan O'Reilly was actually singing Braden Shen's praises last night in between periods, just saying there's no word really you can describe Braden Shen with that is enough. That's how important he is to the Blues lineup. So obviously if Ryan O'Reilly's saying that about you, it's a pretty big deal.
When the spotlight is on, Kendall Coyne Schofield shines.
Feeds it over to Coyne. She scores. That was a beauty.
Whether it's the Olympics or NHL All-Star Weekend, the gold medalist knows how to put on a show. She joined the ladies of NHL Now to show off some of her best moves on the ice. We head to the rink next.
My hockey hero is Kendall Coyne Schofield because she lets me know I can beat all the boys.
Team USA now on the attack. Once more, Coyne, Knight scores! Feeds it over to Coyne, she scores! That was a beauty.
Kendall Coyne making no mistake.
What a feed, great goal!
Here's the star of the All-Star Weekend for me, Kendall Coyne.
Watch the feet move there, the angles are terrific.
I thought she was unbelievable. She was absolutely flying out there.
And there are a lot of little boys out there, but there are a lot of little girls out there too that are watching this and saying, I could be her someday.
There aren't many hockey players more decorated than Kendall Coyne Schofield. Her hardware includes a 2018 Olympic gold medal, 5 IIHF gold medals, and the 2016 Patty Kazmaier Memorial Award for the top female college ice hockey player in the country. Oh, and she also became the first woman to compete in the NHL All-Star Skills Competition last month in San Jose. Coyne Schofield joined Jamie Hirsch and Jackie Redmond in the rink to demo some of her go-to drills and shootout moves. Take a look.
We are happy to bring it to the rink, our demo rink right here at NHL Network. Kendall Coyne, it's your first time on the demo rink here, right?
It is.
Okay, well, she's the expert. We're going to let her really run point on this, but you saw a few things over the past couple weeks or so around the NHL that you thought might be good to really break down for the fans.
Definitely, and there's nothing more exciting to a forward than an odd man rush. A little scary as a defenseman. But we take a look at these goals that happened last night. The first one with Connor McDavid and Leon Draisaitl. We know how great it was to receive the pass, but I think what's key is he got the D to bite to him, and that opened up that space for Leon Draisaitl to score. And then we look at Jack Eichel. He uses his speed effectively. He gets over the blue line, and he makes such a great play. He forces the defenseman to go on his belly, and he said, "Thank you very much. I have all day to shoot and put the puck in the back of the net." And no one shoots the puck like Jack Eichel.
Yeah. Well, I'm probably not going to go down on my belly like that as a defenseman, but I am going to be the defenseman in this demo. Can you maybe show us a little bit, if you and Jackie are on offense together, how you might get me to bite one way or the other?
For sure. And if we think about the first goal, Jack Eichel did pass the puck. We know he can shoot to score. So if your stick is out here like this, what was key to his is he faked it, and I'm on my back and he was on his forehand, but he passes it through the triangle. As a forward, you want to look for that triangle because it's so hard for a defenseman to get that puck inside.
Yeah.
So if you can get that puck through the triangle, there's a good chance it's going to get through, and that's exactly how Connor McDavid did to Leon Draisaitl.
So you're essentially opening up the triangle. Essentially, you're making them get into that position.
You look for that triangle.
Okay.
And then sometimes if that doesn't, if the D takes away the triangle, second play is to come triangle around.
And my foot sometimes makes it hide on you.
Feet do work as a defenseman. And then we take.
Amy's learned a lot from the Hall of Fame defensemen that work here at the network. Oh yeah, Scott's really breaking down.
And then if we break down the second one, in which Jack Eichel shot the puck, that's also super fun as a forward. James, you have your stick out here.
Shoot or shoot, right?
But what you want to get the defenseman to do is to bite that way.
Okay.
So I'm on my forehand, or my backhand. I'm going to open up my forehand, look like I'm going to pass, and shoot.
Yep.
And something I always learned as a kid was always when you're shooting the puck, especially if you're out in your driveway shooting pucks, just shoot on the inside of the post because those are the hardest areas for the goalies to cover. And as you saw Jack Eichel's goal, it was low blocker right at the edge of that post.
And that's the thing when we watch these games, the best snipers in the league, right? Like they pick the tight corners, the tight spots around the net. So if you're practicing at home, that is a really good advice. And speaking of kids at home, there's a lot of kids that watch this show that play hockey, boys and girls alike. So let's talk about some maybe stick handling drills that kids can do at home if they don't have ice necessarily to work with.
Definitely. My favorite place to when I was a kid was my driveway, and something that you can totally do. And this is just a typical street hockey ball. There's nothing crazy about it here. It's
not a big deal.
Love it. And so you can line up. It could be anything. It could be candy. It could be socks. It could be shoes. But anything you saw the players do it in the NHL All-Star Skills Competition. But it's just stick handling through pucks. Here.
In heels.
They're doing it in heels.
In heels, ladies and gentlemen. Yeah. And then, backwards in heels.
And then you can do, like you see all the players in the NHL do, toe drag. So you can continue to pull the ball around here.
Oh, that's good.
Oh, man.
Because she's pulling it back in the same gap that she forwarded.
So to translate it into a game, if Jamie sticks on the ice, if I want to pull it around here.
Yep.
And so you can continuously work on those drills in your driveway. And like we said before, practice shooting those pucks in the corners.
I love it.
Yep.
What about trying to stick handle around your dog? The ball. That's what my dad always made me do when I was a kid. He'd be like, here, take the ball and like try to keep it away from Tucker, which was my dog's name.
We do that with our dogs as well.
Okay.
And then as soon as they start barking, my parents are like, you're done.
Yeah. Game's over.
That's awesome. Really quick, I wanted to go back to what you said about shooting on the inside post, because that seems to be a tough spot for goalies to defend. Is that your go-to move regardless of who's in net, or do you have a specific scouting report on every goalie you face?
I prefer to shoot the puck if I can. I'm typically a faster player, so my feet are moving so fast, sometimes it's hard to make a move right on top of the crease. So I like to shoot, but you have to be able to pick those corners accordingly. So when a lot of young kids, I know there's so many kids that have reached out to me and say, I shoot 100 pucks a day, I shoot 200 pucks a day, which is incredible.
Yeah.
But it's where are you shooting those pucks? Make sure you're effective.
What are you trying to hit?
Exactly, because if you're shooting your pucks and you're hitting them right here, they're not going to go in the game.
It's going
right into the goalie's belly.
Right, and when Kendall and company won the gold medal just a year ago, it came down to a shootout. So what is your go-to shootout?
I can't disclose that.
Oh,
hey.
Okay, top five, or is that still too much? It's too much.
No, like, okay, I can
Yeah, maybe it. Your fifth best move that you
make. Okay, Shaden Zabados. Plug your ears.
We've got a playoff game coming up, though. You're right. We
have
to be careful here.
No, she's great. But I prefer, I like to come in on my forehand. I like to come on my forehand, pull to my backhand, and if I can, go upstairs.
Up top. Okay.
And then my second,
backhand shelf. No,
exactly.
That's a swaggy move. I like it.
And then the last one I like to do is I always come across here. And similar to Jack Eichel's goal is I like to shoot across
and
into that low corner, blocker side.
Wow.
And she's one of the best.
There's a reason.
That was really good stuff.
Up next, the Bruins have been on fire.
Krejci scores! The Bruins come from 2-2. Burn them!
Brad Marchand and company have the Bees fans dreaming of another cup. We'll break down two of Boston's biggest goals this week after the break. Keep it here.
The Boston Bruins' point streak reaches 17 games. They look dangerous with a capital D.
These guys, they look like world beaters at this point.
A rocket for Brad Marchand!
He just rips that.
I don't think many people forecast six goals by Boston with Pastrnak not available.
First full month without a regulation loss since November 2011.
The Bruins come from 2-2 and strip the whale of its blubber. Burn him!
The Bruins have been red hot as of late, sitting in second place in the Eastern Conference, and a big reason has been the play of Brad Marchand. who is less than 10 points from his career high. On Tuesday, Boston continued their point streak with the help of Marchand, and he's streaking B's teammates. EJ and Stu broke down two of the crucial goals in Boston's big win.
We had a shorty as well. Patrice Bergeron, what's up? So take us through that.
Yeah, I wanted to look at the shorthanded goal, which is an important goal, obviously, in the game, and then also the game winner. But let's start with this one, and it's a terrific play by Brad Marchand, who really reads this play along the boards by Falk. He sees him. He's on his outside shoulder. He gets the puck for Justin Williams. He kind of flies by him. And then you have, look at this, you have poor Sebastian Aho.
Great
offensive player, but he's in the defensive mode against Bergeron and against Marchand there. And lefty and righty on the opposite sides off wings makes it even harder with the defense.
Yeah, if this was Drew Doughty or Duncan Keith, it'd be a hard two guys to face on a 2-on-1. So the fact that it's Aho.
I like this here, because he just stays off his shoulder and reads it really well.
He basically, without being able to see his eyes, still could tell what he wanted to do. And that's a tough play for Falk.
DeBrusque and Krejci were a fantastic tandem in the Boston-Carolina setup. Krejci's going to get the opportunity here in the early going. Watch him drive.
Oh, dangle.
Great chance, and then DeBrusque. How about that tuck from in tight? Does a terrific job of getting it up right there. That's a tight little tuck. And I'll tell you what, falling away from the net as he does it. Terrific play by DeBrusque. Great anticipation, great instincts to go to the net. This one's a favorite, though, and I had to lay some graphics in on this one. Krejci does a terrific job driving it deep. He's actually going to get an opportunity here, but watch DeBrusque on the follow-up. He's going to pop into your screen right there. Rather than swing by the battle and kind of feign the stick check, he stops at the battle, deft little touch on the stick, disrupts the defender, and then he gets frozen off from the inside, and he'll actually pivot back away from the defender and find Krejci. Let's break it down in kind of a slower frame by frame. Here's what I like about it. Stops at the battle rather than swinging to one corner or another. Shows great discipline there, shows great defensive or maybe offensive instincts. And then how about the stick-on-stick contact? It's kind of obscure. It's a little under the radar. Avoids a minor penalty. Spots Krejci coming in from the mid slot, but he recognizes, hey, I'm frozen out from the inside. I can't go directly to the inside. What does he do? He's going to roll off, pivot back to the outside, and fires a strike across the low paint into Krejci. That's your overtime winner. That's a big play. That was outstanding.
Coming up, the Maple Leafs offense has looked unstoppable at times. Tavares and Matthews are Toronto's household names, but it's another Leaf who has been the straw that stirs the syrup up north.
He might be the MVP of this team. As crazy as it sounds, it's all Mitch Marner on this.
Been a tenacity and a doggedness.
Austin Matthews gives the Leafs the lead and continues to torment the Buffalo Sabres.
And there's the fifth goal in six games for Austin Matthews.
Bang, bang, play in the Leafs lead. All the Maple Leafs and their fans needed that.
What a move by Ennis.
It's a hat-trick goal for Tyler Ennis.
Hats are coming out.
This is turning into an ugly night.
It just seems like that kind of night, though, doesn't it?
The Toronto Maple Leafs are not short on star power. Led by Austin Matthews and John Tavares, the Leafs are eyeing their third consecutive postseason berth. But it's not Matthews or Tavares who lead Toronto in points. Mitch Marner currently claims that title. And Jamie Hirsch shows us why he might be Toronto's MVP. Take a look.
One thing that really stood out to me about Mitch Marner is that he might be the MVP of this team. As crazy as it sounds, watch him here on this little breakdown. Just creates the turnover in the other zone and takes it himself. Now, he doesn't score here, but he creates that scoring chance. And soon after that, it's Zach Hyman who buries the rebound there. It's all Mitch Marner on this. This is, again, the first one, but he then had another beautiful assist, and we'll watch that here. This is a little later in the game. And just look what he does to TJ Brody. Just undresses him. Just spins him right around, right?
It was unbelievable. That little pump fake and had the D spinning and backdoor goal.
Yeah.
And he had Hyman ready, right? Like, that play doesn't finish unless the guy is in the right place in front to finish it.
And if that weren't enough, later on, it's 5-2. We're in the third period. And check him out. He just throws it to the net. Like you said, good things happen. He ends up scoring this one. I don't even think he was trying to, But hey, he'll take it. A goal and two helpers brings his points total to 81 on the season. You mentioned the historical nature of that stat to have him get to the 80-point mark so quickly. But it's amazing to see what he's done. Just 10 points even in his last four games. I know we're showing his last six here, but I think he's a big reason why the Leafs have now won five of six.
The Nashville Predators find themselves towards the top of the Western Conference standings, and this past week they took two from the Minnesota Wild, both in shootouts. On Sunday, it was Philip Forsberg playing hero as he scored the game-tying goal with less than 5 minutes remaining in the third period. Here's Stu Grimson on what he saw from Forsberg's clutch goal.
He's a big game player. He really is. He's a big moment player, and I like this particular moment. Philip is one of those rare guys that's kind of capable of manufacturing offense out of the thin air. Does a terrific job, and there's just a few things I want to kind of tease out. Here's Forsberg, nearest to us in the shot. Watch the job he does, kind of building a wall around this defender, gaining the offensive blue line, and then how about loses the puck, quick little, I'll kick it up off my skin,
no big
in
deal.
Stride, bump it back up to my stick, like that's what you do in this situation. Recognizes that lane is plugged. He can't take it to the lane. I'll dish off to Yossi, and I'll go to the net myself just in case something forms in and around the net. This is the part I'm talking about. The average player would fall off either way. Take a swing up the half wall, take a swing behind the net. Forsberg stops in that lane right there, hits the hammers, great discipline, great instincts, and he gets rewarded.
Well, that's all the time we have for this week's NHL Tonight Breakdowns and Demos. I'm Jameson Coyle. Thanks so much for watching, and we'll see you again next time.